such an experience.
You know, my mom says there's no such thing as love between men and women. Love for your children, yes, but love for a man, no. What do you think?
I don't know.
Well, that makes two of us then. So I'm buggered if I do.
Weren't you in love with your man who was killed?
Jamie. I can't remember what he looked like. I think I loved him. But when you can't put him in your mind, you begin to doubt it. That's the trouble with port and lemon. Truth pours out.
There you are, Lieutenant. We were just saying how proud we all are of the job you uniformed chaps are doing. Our youngest will be joining up next Easter, just in time for the big push, I hope, eh? Well, tell your men that one day the bells will ring to tell us it's all over. Till then, those of us still at home are with you every step of the way.
What does that mean? Dulce, pulce.
Dulce et decorumis pro patria mori. Means it is sweet and honourable to die for your country.
I'm glad it's in Latin. If that were in English, there's a good few widows would laugh at it.
Which way's your lodgings?
My lodgings? My lodgings won't do you any good. My landlady's a dragon. 50 times worse than my mum.
Shall we go for a walk? I don't fancy saying goodnight just yet. Do you?
Penny for them.
I was thinking about a man in my platoon. Wrote the same letter to his wife every week for 2 years.
How do you know he did?
Because I had to censor it. Every week I had to read all their letters.
Who read yours?
Nobody. They rely on our sense of honor.
You lot make me sick. I suppose nobody else has got a sense of honor.
Short ass buggers, the Scots. I'll see you again.
Maybe.
We could have a bit to eat in Edinburgh and then go somewhere on the train after. Sunday.
Sally Pryor.
Sarah.
I've been confined to the hospital for 2 weeks.
This is the army, Mr. Pryor. There are rules. Apparently, Matron saw you in town. You weren't wearing your hospital armband.
I was looking for a girl, which, as you may or may not know, is not made any easier by walking around with a band on your arm saying I'm a loony.
Yes, well, I'm sure Major Bryce will reconsider his action if you give him good reason.
Aren't you going to ask me if I got one?
One what?
Girl. A woman. Woman.
No, I wasn't.
Well, I did. She's a munitionette. She's very pretty.
Mr. Pryor, would you like to leave it for today?
No.
All right. Let's go back to the time immediately following the April 23rd attack. Have you made any progress beyond that?
No. I don't want to talk about that. Something you said's been bothering me. You said officers don't suffer from mutism.
That's right. Officers tend to suffer from stammering. It's the lower ranks who suffer from mutism.
Why?
We don't know. Even the dreams of officers, and believe me, I've studied thousands, tend to be more elaborate than those of the other ranks.
I'd rather have their dreams than mine.
How do you know? You don't remember yours.
I refuse to believe that General Haig's dreams are more elaborate than those of the lowest ranker. All those noodle-brained dimwits who think they're born to lead as if God gave them a birthright over others.
Well, you certainly conquered your mutism, Mr. Pryor. Interesting, isn't it, that you're one of the very few people here who doesn't stammer?
I think it's even more interesting that you do.
It's at the end of my appointment for today, Mr. Pryor.
Maybe you're the one who's ill.
We've watched you playing cricket and every kind of game. At football, golf, and polo, you men have made your name. But now your country calls you to play your part in war.
Now this is good. Red lips are not so red as the stained stones kissed by the English dead. It's absolutely perfect. And, this one. Dead youth. I thought anthem.
This one? Anthem for dead youth.
We'll work at it, and then bring it back and we'll have a go at it together. Is it traumatic for you?
No. Writing is like exorcism.
Well, if you ever get back to the front, at least it'll be good for your poetry.
Yes. Yes, it would. Gas. Gas. Quick, boys. An ecstasy of fumbling, fitting the clumsy helmets just in time. But someone still was yelling out and stumbling and floundering like a man in fire or lime. Dim, through the misty panes and thick green light, as under a green sea, I saw him drowning. In all my dreams, before my helpless sight, he plunges at me, guttering, choking, drowning. If in some smothering dreams you two could pace behind the wagon that we flung him in and watch the white eyes writhing in his face, his hanging face like a devil sick of sin. If you could hear at every jolt the blood come gargling from the froth-corrupted lungs, obscene as cancer, bitter as the cud of vile incurable sores on innocent tongues, my friend, you would not tell with such high zest to children ardent for some desperate glory the old lie, dulce et decorum est, pro patria mori.